Thank you. Dear Guarneros Award laureate Sandra Diaz, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Royal Norwegian Society of Sciences and Letters and Norwegian University of Science and Technology, it is a pleasure for me to welcome you all to this ceremony for the Guarneros Award for Sustainability Science. The aim of this award is to honor science that can promote a sustainable world. In its essence, sustainability science is interdisciplinary, combining ecological, economic, social, and political factors. Research can contribute to a better quality of human life in accordance with the limits of nature. The Guarneros Award in Sustainability Science has the ambition of encouraging such research. The prize is awarded to a person who has given outstanding contributions to sciences of importance to the development of a sustainable society. I should tell you why the award has this name, the Guarneros Award. Who is or was this Guarneros? Johan Ernst Guarneros was the founder of the Royal Norwegian Society of Sciences and Letters back in 1760. He was a bishop, but he was also a scientist, studying the nature in many forms. He was interested in fishes, birds, and plants, which he wrote articles about in the journal the society founded. His diocese covered all northern Norway, and as he made his visits to the priests in the diocese and wrote letters to them, he encouraged them to study the nature and cultivate knowledge. It would be a shame for us, he told them, if we did not aim at well-founded knowledge. The work of Guarneros was interdisciplinary, locally as well as internationally. His work with collecting species and writing articles about them drew attention in the learned world at the time, and he discussed his findings and exchanged exotic objects with the European contact network. His most permanent correspondence partner was the Swedish botanist Carl von Linné, from whom he received the inspiration for his Flora Norvegica. The Guarneros Award was established by the Royal Norwegian Society of Sciences and Letters in 2012 and has been awarded in cooperation with the university since 2017. This is the third time the prize is awarded. The Science Society and the University have a joint ambition to contribute to the continuing efforts to make science count in the effort to obtain a sustainable world. I will give the floor to Rector at NTNU, Gunnar Bovim, who will read the jury citation.
Dear Guarneros Prize laureate Sandra Diaz, President, ladies and gentlemen, this is a proud moment for the Norwegian University of Science and Technology and for the Royal Norwegian Society of Sciences and Letters. Today, Professor Sandra Diaz receives the Guarneros Award in Sustainability Science 2019 for her work in biodiversity. This is the jury citation. Biodiversity is the variety of life on Earth in all its forms and all its interactions. Professor Diaz is one of the leading scientists in the world developing theories and empirical understanding of the role of biodiversity in sustainable development. She has helped us understand how humans not only benefit from nature, but also how we shape the ecology and the evolution of the living world. Understanding and managing these processes are the core of sustainability science. Sandra Diaz is a professor at Cordoba National University in Argentina and senior principal researcher of the Argentine National Research Council. Her main work is in ecosystem ecology, biodiversity, plant traits, and global environmental change. She has contributed significantly to how we understand plants and how they relate to global change processes like climate change. Diaz's recent studies bridge the gap between ecology and social sciences and has advanced interdisciplinary approaches in science and biodiversity. This year, Sandra Diaz was ranked by Nature magazine as one of the 5 scientists to watch for her role in co-leading the UN Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystems Services, and for the report Global Assessment of Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. The Guneros Award in Sustainability Science is an international research prize that is jointly awarded by the Royal Norwegian Society of Sciences and Letters and Norwegian University of Science and Technology. The award winner receives 1 million Norwegian kroner, a medal, and a diploma. The Guneros Award winner must show excellence in science, excellence in footprints, and excellence in sustainability science. Based on these criteria, the conferring parties unanimously concluded that Professor Sandra Diaz was outstanding and the top candidate for 2019 Guneros Award in Sustainability Science. It gives me great pleasure, therefore, to call upon Professor Sandra Diaz to receive the 2019 Guneros Award in Sustainability Science. To physically give you the Guneros Award, Professor Diaz, we have a very special guest waiting backstage, someone who has proven a sincere interest and dedication to sustainable development and innovation, and that reflects the importance and prestige of this award. Please give a warm welcome to His Royal Highness, the Crown Prince of Norway, Håkon Magnus.
We tend to see nature as some untouched wilderness out there. And of course, nature is that, but it goes well beyond.
Nature is actually all the living fabric around us and deeply interwoven with us, all the way from the remote wilderness to the food on our table, to our garden, and even the stories we think about and tell to each other. We are also told that in view of the future, we need to choose between nature and us. But this is a false dilemma. The dilemma is not either nature or us, simply because nature is us. We don't have a livable future without nature. Nature, therefore, far from being a luxury, is everyone's birthright. So we need to work for a better future for the whole fabric of life on Earth, including us. We are not starting from scratch. We have accumulated a massive amount of knowledge over time. Knowledge about nature, how it works, and how to deal with it. Knowledge that is coming from different disciplines and communities of practice. The knowledge of very different peoples around the world. Therefore, the biggest challenge right now is how to make the best of all this accumulated collective knowledge. How to bring all these different streams of knowledge together. How to interweave them for action for a better and fairer world.
panelists, many thanks. Playing in honor of this year's winner of the Guarneros Award. And now, ladies and gentlemen, you've heard about the winner, you've heard about her work. It's time to let her speak for herself. So please put your hands together for Professor Sandra Diaz.
Your Royal Highness, ladies and gentlemen, I am immensely honored to receive this year's Guarneros Award in Sustainability Science. I would like to express my deep gratitude to the Royal Norwegian Society of Science and Letters, to the Norwegian University of Science and Technology, and to the members of the jury who judge me deserving of this award. Sustainability, both ecological and social, is no doubt one of the major challenges of our times and years to come. Because of this, the establishment of an award at this level, specifically for sustainability science, is nothing short of visionary. At the same time, it carries great responsibility and expectations. I, of course, don't have the solutions in terms of knowledge or agency to achieve a sustainable future. No individual has. It's simply too big. Therefore, I accept this award humbly, in full realization that during my career, I have been contributing tiny pieces of an extremely large and complex puzzle, a puzzle that has to be solved collectively by the vast majority of us, or will not get solved at all. I dedicate this award to all those with a passion for knowledge, to all those whose vision and stubborn work made the world move every day. And now, I would like to share with you some of these tiny pieces of the puzzle we've been contributing with our research in the past years. I would like to talk to you about the fabric of life on Earth. Who of you think you understand exactly what I mean when I talk about the fabric of life? This is interesting because you are all threads in the fabric. Maybe it's clear if I say the fabric of life is simply the living world around us and inside us too. Maybe simpler if I say the fabric of life is simply nature. And then we all understand, because nature has always captured our imagination. But many people still think that nature is just some wilderness in a hidden corner of the Earth. But the idea of nature and how we relate to it has changed dramatically in the past decades. Until recently, we thought of nature as something completely separate from us, some bounty, some resources out there for us to be conquered and exploited in our great enterprise for economic growth. And biodiversity loss was seen as a lamentable but unavoidable collateral damage from the great human enterprise. Or alternative, biodiversity, nature, has been seen as some idyllic Eden out there, which we have to protect by isolating it as much as possible from us. But in both visions, nature is starkly separate from us. But now we know that both ideas are simply not sustained by the scientific evidence. We know that nature is not an idyllic Eden out there. Our capacity to modify, to reconfigure nature has increased dramatically in the past 50 years, to the point that now there's hardly any corner in the world which doesn't bear at least a tiny stamp from human actions. So indeed, now, nature on Earth is human nature. And we need to transition from trying to isolate us from towards a better stewardship of it, much more responsibility, because isolation is no longer possible. Also, scientific evidence shows very clearly that we cannot isolate our well-being from nature. It doesn't matter where we live, all of aspects of our life are inextricably interlinked with the fabric of life. The fabric of life is indeed the remote wilderness out there, but it's also the weedy wasteland in your block, is the fish and apples on your table. Nature is also the microbiome you carry in your intestines wherever you go and maybe affecting your outlook on life. No matter whether you live in the highest floor of the tallest building on Earth, you are inextricably entangled with nature, not only in terms of your dependence, but also in your effects on nature, some of which you may not even be aware of. Nature provides vital contributions to people. It provides the physical materials for our individual and cultural continuity. It underpins all dimensions of human health. It's the basis for art, myth, scientific, and technological discovery. Nature underpins our personal and social identities. We are not really ourselves without nature. So one of the reasons I really like the metaphor of a fabric is because it conveys this idea of support, of safety net, of a fabric of interwoven threads. Some of these threads are us. But that's not the only reason why I like the fabric of life metaphor. I also like it because it conveys very well what natural scientists can do and what we cannot do for life on Earth. And I realized about the second meaning as part of a personal story. Who of you have visited Morocco? Okay. Of those who have visited, who have not bought a carpet there? I was visiting Morocco, specifically the city of Fez, and I went to one of these fantastic carpet shops. And the guys in charge there are really knowledgeable about carpets, so they can teach you a good deal while trying to sell you a carpet. And the first thing they taught me is that a carpet, like any fabric, has two main components, a warp and a weft. The weft is the most immediately apparent component. It has a richness of textures and colors. Whereas the warp is composed of duller, coarser, and more uniform threads, but provides core support to the whole carpet. As customers, we always focus on the colorful weft. Very few people in the world would buy a carpet just because it has a good warp. But those who are in the carpet business look at the warp first, because they know that without a good warp, any fabric, no matter how beautiful it is, would simply unravel. And we can also distinguish a warp and a weft in the fabric of life. For example, all the members of the great tradition of field ecology and natural history, including Bishop Guneros, have relished on the exquisite variety of life on Earth, on the many ways in which each organism is different from all other organisms, in the exquisite ways in which each species adapts to its unique environment in its specific way. But in parallel, there has been another tradition in ecology, equally ancient, that focuses not on the differences, but rather on how the different organisms, underneath the difference, are all similar. It focuses on the generalities, on the general rules of patterns that make organisms similar to each other. And we call that second tradition the Lampers in ecology. And I consider myself as part of them. So let me tell you a little bit of an exercise of massive lamp in ecology we carried out recently. There are almost 400,000 species of plants known to science on Earth. And they contain an astonishing variety of form and function. But some of us were interested in knowing whether underpinning all this richness, there were some small number of simple rules and patterns that would allow us not only to relish on this variety, but also to understand it mechanistically and be better stewards of plant life on Earth. Basically, we were interested in whether we could find common ways in plants to manage what Charles Darwin defined as the struggle for existence. That is how plants manage with growth, survival, and reproduction. And obviously, we cannot follow each of these hundreds of thousands of species all the way from seed to litter to understand how they do it. It's just not feasible. So we took a shortcut, and that shortcut is plant functional traits. Plant functional traits are the phenotypic characteristics of individual organisms that are important for their responses to the environment and are also important for the effects on ecosystem properties. An easier way to understand this is to think of, if you look at a person carefully, you get an idea of this person's general profession and general way of life. The same with functional traits. They give you clues of what the plant is reacting in the face of drought or cold or nutrient limitation. It also gives you clues on how this plant affects other organisms, including ourselves, and affects ecosystem processes. So we were interested in looking at functional traits of the plant's leaves, stems, and seeds. We use seed size as an indicator of general reproduction strategy. We use the plant height and stem density as indicators of the capacity to survive and preempt resources. And we use a number of physical and chemical characteristics of the leaves as indicators of the general pace of life of the plant. And we gather information on all these traits for many plants on Earth, actually 10% of the total of plants known to science. We wanted to be comprehensive, so we managed to make sure we got the tiniest plants on Earth, which is about 1 millimeter, all the way to the tallest one, which are almost 100 meters tall. We got the smallest seeds, which are dust-like, all the way to the biggest seed on Earth, which is more than 20 kilograms. And we also managed to make sure that we had the tiniest leaves and also the largest leaves on Earth. And what we wanted to do with all this information is to build the multidimensional space of basic design of all plants on Earth. So if you can imagine a hypercube, not just a three-dimensional cube, a six-dimensional cube, each of the dimension one of these traits, the question was, how are plants distributed in this hyperdimensional cube? If any plant can have any combination of seed size, length, and leaf characteristics, then they will be equally distributed all around this hypercube. Plants on Earth will form a volume that would look like a blob. On the other hand, if some combinations between seeds and stems and leaves characteristics are just not feasible or very unlikely, then plants will tend to be concentrated in some corners of the theoretical hypercube. And we expected a bit of a blob. And we carried a number of analytical procedures, and the final result was this. Far from being a blob, the space design of all plants on Earth is a very constrained space. So constrained that 75% of the total multidimensional variation is contained in just one plane, this plane, which we call the global spectrum of plant form and function. Forget for the moment the colors. Each point here is a species on Earth, and this area of the spectrum is occupied by tiny plants with tiny seeds and tiny leaves, all the way to this area which is occupied by large plants with large leaves and seeds. This area of the spectrum is occupied by plants with really conservative leaves. They are sturdy leaves, they grow slowly, they stay forever. All the way to these kind of leaves, which are tender, rich in nitrogen, they grow fast, and they die young. What this means is that despite the fact that plants are very baroque in the details of their adaptation to the environment, in their general very basic design of how they grow, survive, and reproduce, they are very, very constrained. Actually, you can capture the essential design of any vascular plant in just two coordinates on this space. So that was, in my opinion, interesting. Let me show some example of plants in different areas of the spectrum so you have a better idea. Here we have the tall tropical plants like the Brazil nut. This area is the realm of the gymnosperms, including, for example, Araucaria, the monkey puzzle. All this area is the territory of stress-tolerant plants. Very small, conservative leaves, these plants are very good to survive in surviving harsh environments. Here we have weedy, small plants. They grow fast, they die young. And this interesting space is the domain of the plants associated with us. Most of our crops are here. Most of the psychoactive plants with which we have fun and which poison each other are here. All the plants which are our unintended companions, like weeds and agricultural weeds and wasteland plants, etc., plants that go with us everywhere we go, are here. So this is the human region of the global spectrum of plant and function. Now, we thought that this constraint of the space was interesting, but even more interesting was the fact that plants are not equally distributed in all the space. And now I will ask you to concentrate on the colors. This is a probability density map, meaning that the red areas are areas in where there are very many plants with more or less the same combination of traits, with more or less the same design. And the yellow and whitish areas are areas very unpopular in terms of trait combinations. Very few plants have these combinations of traits. So most of plant diversity on Earth actually lies in this really hot spot of functional diversity. And here you can see areas in which a lot of plant designs are physically possible, but they are just not being very popular. All this is the hallmark of selection in action. Both natural selection over long-term evolution and also fast human-driven selection. Now, this is particularly relevant because, as our recent report shows, we have had a massive effect over the past 50 years on nature, and the biggest effect is actually land use change. This is exerting a huge selection pressure on plants. The fabric of life is not getting smaller as a result of our actions, it's also getting thinner and more threadbare and more frayed. All the global indicators of the state of nature are going down, and we are even altering the evolutionary process itself. So it's not like nature is becoming a smaller version of itself. We are changing in a non-random way. We are really making some plants winners and some other plants losers. So this shift, this hot and cold zones, is shifting as we speak. And we have the theory at the moment to predict, at least to some degree, which areas of the spectrum are likely winners and which areas of the spectrum are likely losers as we exert pressures on nature. Therefore, we can anticipate, at least in comparative terms, how these hot and cold spots are going to shift as a result of our actions. Not only that, because a plant's general design tells you about what kind of things these plants can do for the rest of the ecosystem and what positive and negative contributions these plants can have for people. We can also anticipate to some degrees how nature's contributions to people are going to look like as these hot and red and spots shift in the global spectrum. For example, These are some ecosystem properties and some nature's contributions to people that are strongly depending on the syndromes, on the functional characteristics of the locally most abundant plants. So, what I call warp ecology, that is general quantitative plant ecology, can do, is very important in trying to be better stewards of the warp of life on Earth. We are making good contributions. However, as I said at the beginning of the talk, nobody buys a carpet because it has a good warp. No matter how beautiful they intellectually may be, the global spectrum model or any other models in plant ecology, nobody's going to take to the streets because of the models. The warp of life doesn't make people tick. The marvelous, rich, diverse weft does. And natural scientists have a lot to contribute to understanding of the warp, but it's not enough to understand all the ways in which nature is important and meaningful for different people around the world. It's not enough to understand how all these biophysical processes end up being translated to human well-being, end up being translated in a fulfilling life for the many different social actors in this marvelous, diverse human world. For understanding this, we need the social sciences and the humanities. We need citizens, of course, working in close interactions with the natural sciences. So, in summary, we are not truly ourselves without the fabric of life on Earth on which we are intergoven. And the fabric of life is unraveling worldwide. It's not just a few holes, it's not just the weft, it's the whole thing which is unraveling. Therefore, we really need to understand it much better. We really need to manage it much better urgently. And for doing that, the warp approach of the fabric of life, the traditional quantitative models of natural sciences is extremely useful, it's indispensable, but it's not enough. We also need a warped approach. We also need other disciplines and streams of knowledge in trying to understand much better how the fabric of life means different things for different people across the world. And I would like to finish by thanking all these friends and colleagues who have made my career both productive and very pleasurable. Thank you very much, everyone, for your attention.